This is Phyllis Silver. I am the director of the Partnership for Quality Care. This is our sixth webinar in the series of Beyond the Bundle series, which was named by one of our consultants to this work, from Kaiser Permanente, Jed Weisberg, who's the Senior Vice President of Hospital for Quality and Care Delivery Excellence. And thank you for coming up with the name and being such a wonderful advisor to all of this work, Jed. I know that people are anxious, interestingly enough, so that everybody knows, the turnout we've had for this webinar, and I assume that it's because of the national reputation of Dr. Carcillo, as well as the subject matter of pediatric sepsis. We've had double the registration that we've had for anything in the past, and that's really quite impressive. I'd like to welcome some of our non-Partnership for Quality Care participants. We've had a number of people sign on today who are from other organizations, from General Electric, from iPro in New York, the Improving Healthcare for Common Good, from Intermountain Healthcare, from the National Quality Forum, the State Department of Health, University of Rochester Medical School, just to name a few of the participants today that are beyond the membership of the Partnership for Quality Care. We welcome you and hope that you enjoy today's webinar. I'm going to turn this over to the person who is the chair of work for the Partnership of Quality Care, Scott Young. Dr. Young is the Associate Executive Director of Clinical Care and Innovation and the Senior Medical Director and Executive Director of the Care Management Institute at Kaiser Permanente. Scott.
Thank you, Phyllis, and really thank everybody today for making time in your schedule to learn more about sepsis and, as Phyllis just said, beyond the bundle. We think that this is kind of one of the kind of important causes of our time medically, and we have traditionally been spending a lot of time on finding new and better ways to identify and treat sepsis in the adult population, and really we started thinking about moving beyond that, and what about peds and in our pediatric populations. I think we're becoming more and more aware of just what the catastrophe is of sepsis in children and how it can be now better understood and better treated. We thought of no one better to discuss this subject than Joseph Carcillo. And Dr. Carcillo is the Associate Professor in the Department of Critical Care Medicine and the Department of Pediatrics at the University of Pittsburgh School of Medicine. You know, he went to school at GW, did his residency and his training at the Children's Hospital National Medical Center in D.C. He is a critical care medicine specialist, a pediatric critical care medical specialist, and just a widely published author of many studies that have expanded our understanding of sepsis in children. We had a brief dialogue with him a couple of weeks ago, and I will tell you, just in the little bit of time we spent talking, it expanded not only my awareness of sepsis, but my appreciation of our ability to combat this condition in a real way. We hope you'll find this just as interesting as we did. With that, Joseph, are you on the phone?
I am.
Let me turn it over to you, and thank you.
Okay, well, thank you for the honor and opportunity to speak with you all today. Let me first start off by saying that the Surviving Sepsis Campaign for Children is trying to come to terms with developing a formal document. So what I'm going to give you today is kind of an insight into where I think it will eventually land. In the next year or two, you'll have something a little bit more authoritative. Can everybody hear me okay?
Uh-huh. Yes.
Yeah.
Next slide, please.
Okay.
So if you look at the World Health Organization, when they look at deaths in children under five, it turns out that sepsis is the leading killer worldwide. So if you look at these diseases, pneumonia, diarrhea, malaria, measles, they respond with a 40% improvement in mortality with antibiotics. This comes to $1.7 billion nationally per year. There are actually more deaths in children than in cancer. So it's a very big problem. Now, why do you think it is that we don't think about it too much? The first leading cause of death in the United States is trauma. And, of course, with trauma, you get a call from the outside that there's a child who's been hit by a car or fallen off their bike, and they go through a trauma system. But deaths from sepsis have to be diagnosed by the parent and the physician. Next slide, please. Now, the good news is we now, with recognition.
Can you go on mute, please?
With recognition and therapy, we've seen the mortality rates go from 98% to below 5%. So there's a lot of hope there, but it puts a big onus on the healthcare system to recognize early and treat. Next slide, please.
Okay.
Now, in children, we don't draw blood like we do in adults, so we define sepsis clinically. So sepsis is the presence of tachycardia, which is a fast heart rate, and tachypnea, which is a fast respiratory rate, and a suspicion, which is usually a fever. So if a kid has a fever and is breathing fast or has a fast heart rate, we suspect sepsis. Next slide, please. If you look at newborns, heart rate alone is a very nice sign. Out of 4,350 newborns, only 21 had a fast heart rate, or 4.6 per thousand. So a very nice sign for term babies. 82 of these newborns underwent a sepsis evaluation, meaning blood cultures and a spinal tap, and 13 had sepsis. 12 of the 13 had fast heart rate versus only six of 69 who did not have sepsis. So really, a fast heart rate, and you're trying to recognize the process, is a very good screening tool. Next slide, please. Now, in adults, they can increase their heart rate to 140. If you take the participants in this webinar today and you were to take your pulse, it's about 70. And so your heart rate will go up to 140 and no problems. But in newborns, to go from 140 to 280 is impossible because that's too fast of a heart rate to survive. And in a one-year-old, even 200 is quite high. Next slide, please. This increase in heart rate that you see is in response to hypovolemia on the left-hand side, meaning the heart is too small, or to a decreased ability of the heart to pump on the right. So with a normal cardiac picture or heart picture, you can get the same output at a lower heart rate. But if your heart's sick, as it is on the right, or if your heart doesn't have enough fluid on the left, you'll have a faster heart rate. Next slide, please. So if you see this fast heart rate and you have a fever, then what you want to do is give antibiotics. Next slide, please. Now, it's actually quite interesting. This is Bangladesh, where there are no hospitals, there are no emergency departments, and this study has now been reproduced in Pakistan in the same situation. And here they went out to, with village healthcare workers, to the community, and they taught the parents to recognize abnormal breathing, or poor feeding, or fever, or diarrhea. And if they saw that, then they gave the children oral cotrimoxazole and intramuscular gentamicin for 5 days, and they saw a five-fold reduction rate in mortality rate in these children, meaning that the use of antibiotics when you show these signs reduces infant mortality dramatically from 16% to 2%, even in the absence of hospitals or emergency departments. Next slide, please. This is a look at adults in North America and Canada and in the United States. And here they're looking at the point when the infection has overwhelmed adults and they have a low blood pressure. You can see the fraction of the patients on the vertical axis and the time from hypotension on the horizontal axis. And you can see survival fraction as it relates to the beginning of an effective antibiotic for the infection. And you see that if it, within 1 hour you receive the antibiotics in these adults, the mortality rate was 7%. But each hour after that point in time, their mortality rate went up by another 7%. So it's quite interesting that the time to receiving the antibiotic is the most important factor that predicts outcome. Next slide, please. That's seen in this rendering in a little different way with what's called an odds ratio. You can see that each hour that goes by from the time of hypotension is associated with an increased mortality risk. Now, during this study, the average patient didn't receive an antibiotic for 6 hours when in the hospital from the time of hypotension, which means that their odds of dying was tenfold higher than it needed to be if it had been given in the first hour. So one of the big challenges in a sepsis quality initiative is to set up our hospital systems so they can give an antibiotic within 1 hour of seeing hypotension. Next slide, please. In this slide, you're looking at this odds ratio of death, and it doesn't matter if the infection is documented, suspected, culture positive, culture negative, has bacteremia, doesn't have bacteremia, if it comes from the community, if it's nosocomial, if it's a gram-positive infection, gram-negative infection, fungal infection, respiratory infection, urinary tract infection, intra-abdominal infection, or skin or soft tissue infection. The bottom line is the odds ratio of death goes up the longer it takes before starting antibiotics. Next slide, please. So sepsis is fever in the presence of tachypnea or tachycardia. Septic shock is defined in children as having a capillary refill greater than 2 to 3 seconds, or flash capillary refill, or hypotension. So far, all the criteria I've given you are clinical. Next slide. The way you can do capillary refill is you can press on the finger with a moderate pressure and then let it go. And if the capillary refill is less than 3 seconds, you have fourfold less mortality risk. But if it's three seconds or greater, more than 3 seconds, then you have a fourfold increased odds of dying. So as a triage tool, the capillary refill is very good. It doesn't mean you have septic shock, but if you have sepsis, it's septic shock. There are many other things that do it, but in terms of triaging a patient, not only heart rate, but also capillary refill is very important. And what it's showing when you look at the slide picture is it's showing you the capillary beds, which take time to refill. It's a marker of microvascular disease or dysfunction. Next slide, please. Now, what's recommended is that you restore normal capillary refill and blood pressure, and if you do this, this will decrease your mortality risk by 40%. Alternatively, every hour that goes by without doing it, you have an increased mortality rate. So let's say when the child comes to you, they have a mortality risk of 2%. If it takes you an hour to restore those clinical signs to normal, then that mortality rate will go up to 3.5%. If it takes another hour, 5%, and so on. So the goals in treatment are to restore normal capillary refill and blood pressure. Next slide, please. And these goals have been set out by the American Heart Association, the Pediatric Advanced Life Support, and the Society for Critical Care Medicine. So the early goals are a normal heart rate, capillary refill less than 2 seconds, and normal blood pressure in a time-sensitive manner. So if you see an abnormal capillary refill, or you see an abnormal blood pressure, we give fluids. Some patients get none, some patients get a little, and some patients get a lot. How does the doctor decide how much to give? Well, the doctor checks for a big liver or for RALs in the lungs. This is something that would suggest fluid overload. Or looks at the x-ray if there's a large heart. And if there's evidence of a large liver, a large heart, or RALs, a fluid bolus is not given. But if there is no large liver, if there's no fluid in the lungs, and there's not a large coronal X-ray, then fluids given in 20 ml per kilogram boluses, as long as the capillary refill is decreased and the blood pressure is decreased. Next slide, please. As one gives fluid in this case, you can see the shock index, which is the heart rate divided by the systolic blood pressure, will improve. The heart rate will improve towards normal. The prolonged capillary refill will go towards normal, and the blood pressure will improve. Now, if you look at this figure carefully, what you see is that blood pressure is the last thing to go. So the first thing you see in your patient is an increase in heart rate, then an increase in the heart rate over systolic blood pressure, then an increase in capillary refill, and finally a decrease in blood pressure. And when you give fluids, you'll see them normalize in that factor. So again, these are signs and symptoms that can be measured by the first responders pretty appropriately just with a blood pressure cuff and their fingers. When you take the classic model of, next slide, when you take the classic model of hypovolemia, meaning not enough volume, which is dengue shock, in the third world, you see a tremendous improvement in survival from 40% to 100% survival when you give fluids at 40 mLs per kilo over an hour. So for hypovolemic shock, there's no doubt that fluids are helpful. Now, alternatively, in Africa, where it's not hypovolemic shock, it's just severe anemia, fluids can actually hurt. So you can't simply have an algorithm that says just give fluids. You can have an algorithm that brings the doctor to the bed space, and the doctor can evaluate whether fluids are needed or not. Next slide again. If the fluids aren't working, then the next step is to give an inotrope to help with that cardiac function itself or depression of the heart. Next slide, please. Now, this is a figure from the United Kingdom. They first went out to the community and did community education of parents to teach them what sepsis was. And particularly in London, there is a large problem with meningococcemia. So they taught the parents to recognize that their children had purple spots, to bring them to the emergency room. And then in the emergency room, in the community hospitals, they followed that algorithm of fluids if the liver wasn't down, and then a peripheral inotrope, an antibiotic within the first hour. And what happened was from 1992 to 1997, they saw a reduction in death rate from 22% to 2%, despite the same significance of illness throughout. So you really can make a difference in your hospital delivery systems and your coordination between the community education programs, public health programs, and ultimately transfer to children's hospitals if you take a comprehensive approach to this disease. Next slide, please. Once the children are in the pediatric intensive care unit, you can further improve outcomes by measuring a central venous oxygen saturation, which is a catheter that's placed between the vena cava to the border of the heart. And here, if you keep that oxygen saturation above 70%, you can have an improvement in survival. In this randomized controlled trial in Brazil, they actually reduce mortality from 40% to 11%. So a further quality indicator once you're out of the early recognition in the emergency department is to attain normal mean arterial pressure minus central venous pressure and a venous saturation greater than 70%. Next slide, please. So now what many of us are here today is to say, fine, Dr. Joe, what you said was we have to identify it early. We have to get the appropriate patient to a doctor to look at the patient with a nursing staff that knows what to do in the emergency department, and then we have to get to the ICU. So everyone's on board there. So what kind of tools are available? The best tool that's been published thus far was by the group at Texas Children's Hospital. So I'm just going to go over the tool, what they did, and so you can see this. It's not necessary that you use this specific tool in your institution. You could talk to the thought leaders of your hospital. And as I said, eventually we will, at the Surviving Sepsis Campaign, come up with something that we can use as a routine for anyone that wants to use it. But this is a good start. So they, in the emergency room, first take a temperature of the children who come to the emergency room. A temperature abnormality is considered greater than 100.4 or less than 96 degrees. If they see that in a high-risk patient, meaning a patient who is known to be a cancer patient, a transplant patient, a patient who has a central venous catheter, or a patient with immunodeficiency, then they have a fever, which is considered an infection, and it's in a patient with a poor immune system, they next look at the pulse and the temperature correction. If the heart rate is more than 5 beats higher per increase in Fahrenheit, or more than 10 beats higher than per degree centigrade, and or the child has an abnormal mental status or a capillary refill time of greater than 3 seconds, they move that sepsis patient to a shock room. And in the shock room, we'll talk about what they do. Or if the patient has shock defined by hypotension or prolonged capillary refill. So in your emergency department, then the way you could set it up is you can have the nurses look at the temperature and the heart rate. If the temperature is increased, that's risk for sepsis. If the heart rate is more than 5 beats per degree Fahrenheit or more than 10 beats per degree centigrade, they should be seen and triaged immediately by a physician for sepsis. Or if they have the abnormal temperature with malignancy, bone marrow transplant, asplenia, solid organ transplant, a present central venous catheter, or immunodeficiency, they should be seen by a physician to rule out sepsis. If they have abnormal mental status, a prolonged capillary refill, or hypotension, they should be sent to the shock room to be seen by the physician. Next slide. Now, the nursing order set that they suggest in this paper is an automatic nursing order set. So if the patient gets referred to the shock room, place them with a nursing order set on supplemental oxygen, the pulse ox, with cardiopulmonary monitoring, and measure the vital signs every 15 minutes and record the pulse ox and every 15 minutes and apply the supplemental oxygen, pulse ox, and cardiopulmonary monitoring within 5 minutes. Vascular access should be obtained within 5 to 10 minutes, and the physician should be notified if there's no access after 5 minutes. A Foley catheter should be placed, and strict monitoring of urine output and fluids administered should be done from the onset and apply to a vital sign flow sheet, which we'll see subsequently. In the nursing order set for blood pressure support, there has to be an assessment by the doctor to see if the patient needs fluid or not, or a little bit or a lot. The maximum amount that you give is 20 mLs per kilo, IV, up to 3 boluses, with the maximum quickness being 15 minutes start to full bolus. This may or may not be needed. It can be given slower or in lesser amounts. For example, 10 ml per kilogram boluses for patients with cardiac conditions, BMT patients, and patients immediately after a lung transplant. For vasoactive agents, if it's warm shock, norepinephrine should be administered through a central line. If it's cold shock, then low-dose dopamine or epinephrine can be given by a peripheral line until a central line is attained. It should be ordered with the completion of the third bolus, according to this protocol, although I usually do them simultaneously. Next slide. The antibiotic therapy nursing order sheet depends on the patient. If they're high risk, they use piptazo, aminoglycoside, and vancomycin, and they gave it within 30 minutes with piptazo and aminoglycoside given first at the same time via the same line. For asplenia and immunologically normal hosts, they gave ceftriaxone, vanco, nafcillin within 30 minutes with ceftriaxone given first over 3 minutes and then vanco. And in addition, the doctor should assess whether the patient's at risk for adrenal insufficiency. in which case the nursing order set can include stress dose steroids, hydrocortisone, no ACTH stimulation should be performed. So the important thing to notice in all these order sets is everything's done within the first hour. Next slide, please. And the last thing that one does in pediatrics is the actual laboratory radiographic evaluation. This comes first in adults, mostly because of the ease of drawing blood from adults rather than kids. But here, they're similar. It's CBC, chemistries, liver panel, DIC panel, C-reactive protein, venous blood gas with lactate, consider type and screen, blood culture, peripheral and central. We do not hold off giving antibiotics waiting to get a blood culture because it's difficult to get blood. If there's a central line in place, one can certainly draw the blood culture quickly. Radiology, the portable chest x-ray, and it has to be able to be viewed in the emergency room in much the way that it's done with trauma. And then one should page the ICU and the primary care service, a time of protocol initiation with completion of the third bolus, and the ICU charge nurse should receive a page with each shock protocol initiation. Next page. Next slide, please. This may be familiar to some. This is basically the same way that we track anesthesia during the OR. Here you can see you have vital signs, you have respiratory rate, temperature, O2 sat, urine output, Glasgow coma scale, capillary refill, pulses, end-tidal CO2. We have IV fluid boluses 1, 2, 3, 4, zosyn, gentamicin, vancomycin, rocephin, nafcillin, hydrocortisone, Tylenol. And then we have the actual blood gases, VBG, pH, CO2, O2, base excess, SCVO2, lactate, D-stick, DICINR, PTT, MD summary, the time that the shock protocol was discontinued, the time that the PICU was notified, and then the disposition of the patient. For those of you who want to look at this article, this is a slide taken directly from the paper by A.T. Cruz and colleagues, so you can bring this up to get better insights. Now, they, in terms of quality assurance, they use a process tool. Each one of these points is an individual patient. So before they start their QIM, A is time to receiving antibiotic. B is time to receiving the first fluid bolus, and the third fluid bolus. And what you can see is that there were patients who met the goal in all three in the first time period who received everything in less than 60 minutes. So if you were to walk around and ask the staff in the emergency department, do you get your first fluid bolus or your third fluid bolus, your antibiotics in your patient in the first hour, they say, yes, we do, because they remember the patients who did indeed get them. But what you actually see is that there was a lot of variability. The variability goes away when you institute the protocol in 2010, when suddenly the goals are met not just once in a while, but all the time. So this is a quality assurance tool that one can issue for time to antibiotics, time to IV fluids, and time to inotropes when indicated, which is a very nice way to track your improvement. Next slide, please. These are the quality indicators that I suggest that you consider. Again, we don't have a formalized document. One, what are the number of visits to the ED that occurred before admission to the hospital in this last 7 days? Your goal should be zero. The young man from New York who spawned the New York Health Initiative was playing basketball, apparently, and he fell and he scraped his knee. He went into the hospital, into the emergency department, and in his first visit, it was recognized that he was ill. He was given a fluid bolus, and he went home. But he came back 2 days later in septic shock and died. So that patient would have triggered this quality indicator because he had an emergency department visit in the same week before admission for the same underlying diagnosis. So he basically was unrecognized sepsis and septic shock. The next quality indicator would be time to initiate antibiotics if given in the hospital. Now, the reason I say if given is that not all children should receive antibiotics. But if the decision is made to give antibiotics, then there's no reason that they should be given in less than an hour from a goal standpoint. Next is time to initiation of fluid bolus if given in the hospital. Again, not all children require fluid boluses, but if they do give a fluid bolus related to the illness, there's no reason it shouldn't be given in the first hour. Time to initiation of peripheral central inotrope if given in the hospital. Again, not all children require a peripheral central inotrope, but if it's given, it should be given within the first hour. Time to admission to the PICU if admitted to the PICU. The goal here should be 1 hour if you're in a PICU hospital and 2 hours if not. And of course, if you are far away from a PICU and it takes a long time to transport, then one has to use a more generous goal. And then a 7-day readmission for sepsis. The goal, again, would be that there would be no readmissions for sepsis within 7 days of being discharged home. So these are quality indicators that I would suggest using. So we now have time to talk, which is what I really wanted to do, is address questions.
Yeah, I have one while we're waiting. Where is the place for any supplemental therapies in this? Treatment for, maybe suspected adrenal insufficiency or immunoglobulin therapy. Where is that second tier therapy later on after the stabilization, or not indicated at all anymore? Can you talk about that?
Yeah, no, those are all indicated therapies. Those are all indicated therapies afterwards. And I can talk about those. I tried to make this talk oriented towards the questions that people had had beforehand. But those therapies, for the most part, are done in the IVIG. So the indication for IVIG, for gamma globulin, is if you have group A strep, septic shock, or MRSA or staph septic shock with toxic shock, because children don't have the circulating antibodies, so IVIG is recommended for that. The role of hydrocortisone is for any child who has adrenal insufficiency. Adrenal insufficiency is defined by a cortisol level less than 18 while requiring epinephrine or norepinephrine. The dose that is used is the stress dose. It's a continuous infusion with a doubling until one gets the desired effect. The amount that is needed is quite surprising. The stress dose is 2 mg/kg per day, and the shock dose actually goes as high as 50 mg/kg per day. Unlike adult guidelines, where everybody who has shock is on norepinephrine receives hydrocortisone, we only recommend it for patients who have adrenal insufficiency. If you don't have the ability to measure cortisol, then some of the risk factors would be disease where you don't get a signal from the pituitary gland, a history of being on steroids long term where your pituitary gland no longer talks to your adrenal gland, and the Waterhouse-Friedrichsen syndrome, which is purpura fulminans, and then congenital adrenal hyperplasia, which is diagnosed with ambiguous genitalia. It was a bit of an open-ended question. You want to address other therapies besides those two?
No, those are the two. I really just wanted to get some sense for how and when to think about these supplemental therapies. I know we're kind of right into the throes of recognition and resuscitation, and then depending upon the sophistication of the institution, people will have some opportunities for those supplemental therapies. And I really, what I wanted to get from you is a sense of when to start thinking about those, at what course in the therapy, I mean, I get it, it's after stabilization, but I just wanted to get a little bit more on that, and I think you provided that.
Yeah, so I'm happy to give another webinar on the ICU management, because it's, as you would imagine, it's pretty involved as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm happy to do that if Shannon or whoever wants to invite me back, and I can do that.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Other questions? Oh, I have one here. Let me read it off. Can you define your time zero? Also, any unintended consequences to increase identification, and how do you recommend unintended consequences to increase identification, and how do you recommend addressing? That's from Dr. Angelotti.
Yeah, so Dr. Angelotti, those are really the important questions, right? So time zero to me is the time that the patient encounters the health institution. So it's the time of registration in the emergency department, or the time of being seen in the physician's office. Now, what Dr. Angelotti is bringing up is that 80% of children who come into emergency departments meet the criteria for sepsis. They have fevers and they have tachypnea and tachycardia. So if you recognize all of these patients, you have unintended consequences if you start doing things to them. So the answer is in the triage tool, and they have the exact numbers in that particular article. So to review them, it's the SIRS patients or the febrile patients who have risk factors, you know, cancer patients, immune suppression, all of those patients should be seen by a doctor with immediately at the time of triage. Then it's the patients, as far as sepsis is concerned, who have a fever and have a heart rate that is out of proportion to that fever. So if you have a fever and your heart rate is more than 5 beats higher per degree Fahrenheit, or more than 10 beats per minute per degree centigrade, that patient should be triaged immediately to a physician to see you. What you're basically doing is putting the nurses under a lot of pressure to triage those patients, and the docs are the ones to see it. So the way you could think about it is that when an adult comes to the emergency department and says, I have chest pain, the nurse doesn't sit there and decide whether or not it's an MI. They send them back immediately to the room to be assessed for chest pain, and then the doctor comes over and assesses them. But very few of those patients do they then decide have an MI. It's that sort of thing. Now, the unintended consequences that they found in this, when they introduced this protocol at Texas Children's, was they had more admissions for sepsis, but they had a 50% reduction in mortality, a 50% reduction in use of ventilators, a 50% use of inotropes. So you wind up having more admissions for sepsis, but less overall hospital resource utilization.
Perfect. Do we have any other questions? I have one that has just come over the chat, and here it is. This is from Brenda Downs. Just asked, we have addressed the shock patient, but what about those on the edge, not quite in shock? Is there a recommended to continue monitoring, like lactate? So what do we do for those folks who, you know, you've got a high index of suspicion, but they're just right there?
Right. So they have to be seen by the doctor to assess them as to what needs to be done. I recommend observation in the proper setting. So if it's in a children's hospital, we would observe them in an ICU setting. If you're in a community hospital, I would transfer that patient to a children's hospital.
Yeah. Well, let me ask a related question to that while we're going and while we're waiting for some others to come through. If you are in a rural setting or a community setting that is not used to seeing a bunch of sick kids, where is the, and you talked about central IV access, and that sometimes is very difficult to get. What is the role for interosseous access? Is there any role for IOs in treating kids with septic shock?
Yeah, excellent question. So the first thing you do is try for a peripheral IV, and if within 90 seconds you can't get that, then you go with an intraosseous. That is definitely what you use. And we don't really expect a rural community hospital to be able to place a central line in the child. If you can get the peripheral IV and the intraosseous, you can give the fluids through that, you can give the peripheral epinephrine through that, and you can give the hydrocortisone through that.
Okay.
And then really what we have to work towards is, for children who are this sick, is transport systems that will allow the physician and the community to to get the child transported to referral centers.
All right. Thank you. We have another question here we have a couple of questions here. So let me get the first one from Foster Gueston. Under what circumstances in settings of severe sepsis and septic shock would fluids and antibiotics not be indicated?
Okay, excellent question. So it turns out that people give antibiotics to all severe sepsis and septic shock.
Yeah.
Because you can commonly have co-infections. So even if you suspect a virus, the patients who have viral infections commonly have a co-infection with bacteria. So that's the reason that antibiotics are given in all situations. Now, if a child has fluid overload, presents with cardiomyopathy, like if you look at the x-ray and it's a big heart, or you listen to them, they have Rawls, or if they have a big liver, then we don't give fluids because that tells you they're fluid overloaded. Now, why might they be fluid overloaded? Well, they may not have sepsis or septic shock. They can, in fact, have primary cardiac problems, something called myocarditis. Or if the child's in the first 6 weeks of life, they might have a congenital heart disease, and the treatment there is to use prostaglandins at 0.1 mics per kilo per minute to keep open the PDA. The other group of patients that we don't give a lot of fluids to are patients who have severe hemolytic anemias, like children who have chronic sickle cell disease or thalassemia where they're hemolyzing, and they too have a large heart on x-ray. What they need instead is blood. So essentially it's the fluid overloaded patient. Another patient would be a patient who's on chronic dialysis for renal failure. If they aren't able to get rid of their fluid, we wouldn't give fluid resuscitation for that as well. And if you go back to, let's see, what slide is it? If we go to the nursing order set, it's back several slides where it says fluid resuscitation, you'll see they say give smaller boluses of 10 mLs per kilo for cardiac conditions. So they might still give fluid, but they would just give it a little less aggressively. And for those with severe anemias, they would give blood rather than fluid.
Okay, very good. I have two other questions that have just come in, and I want to get these. One of them from Dr. Chen, and I'm sorry I skipped that one earlier, Dr. Chen. What is the biggest difference between adult and pediatric sepsis treatment for the bundles? Do you give us some sense for that biggest difference?
Yeah, sure. Okay, one is... children have faster heart rates, and they don't drop their blood pressure for a very long time. So you need to recognize children based on increasing heart rates and increasing prolonged capillary refill rather than waiting for hypotension.
Hmm. Okay.
The therapies themselves are that children need an inotrope, not a vasopressor. So in adults, you put in a central line and do norepinephrine, but in children, you start them on adrenaline through their peripheral line or low-dose dopamine. It's very difficult to get a central line in children. And when you get the central line in children, in general, they have a low cardiac output and a high vascular resistance, whereas adults have a high cardiac output, low vascular resistance. The other major difference in the newborn is you have to start prostaglandin because it may not be sepsis, it could be a heart disease. And the final is that most children who are chronically ill need hydrocortisone because a lot of steroids are given in the children's hospitals for many different diseases. So those are the four major differences.
Okay, thank you. One question just came in from Foster Gueston. At your facility, what do you use to define or decide when you use a pediatric bundle versus adult? Is it age? Is it weight? Is it a little bit of both? And what plays into that decision? So this is what happens with an older teen or a
So we use the pediatric bundle under 21.
Oh, wow.
Because the pediatric bundle and the pediatric algorithm, which I didn't show you here because it's more of an ICU, it's more ICU related, and again, I'm happy to come back and talk about ICU management, includes the typical adult patient, the typical pediatric patient, and the patient in between. So our algorithm approaches all of them. The initial bundle is very similar. You see, it's give antibiotics, give a fluid bolus if necessary, and then it's, what's different is we start an inotrope rather than the vasopressor. So the initial checklist bundle is very, very, very similar.
Now, do you push that out to the surrounding hospitals as well? Because I can see, it actually, I'm delighted, but it actually surprised me that you said under 21. I was thinking, 18, and I can actually think hospitals would be, going more towards adult bundles, community hospitals. I mean, do you actually kind of go out and educate your community hospitals around that?
Yeah, so remarkably, what's happened, because I've been part of the SSC for now almost 15 years, is that the adult bundles have become similar to the pediatric bundle, rather than the pediatric bundle becoming similar to the adult bundle. So the way they've become similar is the adult bundles now give more fluid, they give antibiotics sooner, and they give inotropes sooner. So we have not, the pediatric bundles are out there in PALS, and they're out there as part of the American Heart Association education.
Okay, very good.
Yeah.
I want to thank everybody. This is Phyllis Silver. I think this has just been a wonderful, wonderful opportunity. Thank you, Dr. Carcillo, for sharing with us, and we will definitely love to have you back for another webinar on pediatric sepsis. Thank you, everybody, for your attention.